Olivier Mangin, you have 45 minutes to present your work.
Okay, thank you. So, I'm Olivier Mangin. I'm presenting today the work from my thesis about the emergence of multimodal concepts from perceptual motion primitive to grounded acoustic world. So, I would like to start my presentation with two simple examples. So, the first one is this painting from Salvador Dalí. It illustrates two ideas that are important with respect to my work. The first one is that when we perceive an image, we perceive it actually composed of several objects. Here you can see swans here and elephants below and other objects. And also, these objects are themselves composed of parts. For example, the heads and legs of the elephants. The second idea is that the decomposition is ambiguous. That means that the same image here can be perceived on the top as a swan and on the bottom as an elephant. Let's now look and listen to a short video. So I guess most of you heard da. Actually, this is the sound of someone saying ba with the video of him saying ga. This famous effect is called the McGurk effect, and it illustrates the fact that perception involves several modalities. And here it's vision and audition. And what we perceive at the end is a combination of the stimulus coming from both these modalities. So the main question I will address in this presentation are those of the mechanisms that underlie the structure of perception, for example, those leading to the perception of objects inside a picture, but also the mechanisms that relate what is perceived in one modality to what is perceived in another. I'll start my presentation with some background about the scientific context of this work, then give details on the structure of motion, the structure of sound and speech, and also introduce my contributions. I'll then present three experiments about recognizing parts of motion, learning association between gestures, words, and objects inside images, and also another contribution about using similar ideas for the imitation of motions. This work is part of the developmental robotic approach. It thus focuses on building artificial cognitive systems. But as suggested by Alan Turing, we do not try to simulate the adult brain, but rather the child's brain. Therefore, the field of developmental psychology is a major inspiration for us. And in particular, Jean Piaget insisted on the fact that intelligence organizes the world by organizing itself simultaneously between both sides of that interaction. So following that idea, we do not focus on cognition for itself, but rather adopt a systemic approach that studies the nature of the stimulus, along with the structuration of the perception for that stimulus. In this work, we explore a set of techniques in order to build artificial cognitive systems that feature capabilities that are analogous to the one observed on children. However, we do not claim that these techniques are the one used by the human brain. So let's take another example. if we look at this volleyball player and as emphasized on the picture, the motion she performs is actually composed of a succession of simpler gestures. So for example, she launches the ball, goes forward, jump, hits the balls, and then land. Following this intuition, a large amount of work has been done to find mechanisms that can decompose a complex motion into a sequence of simpler gestures. Such approaches uses, for example, techniques based on hidden Markov models, but also on reinforcement learning, optimal control, or dictionary learning. If we give another look to the same volleyball player, we notice that the player is actually looking at the ball during the whole motion. Also, she starts going forward before finishing to actually launch the ball and prepares to land before having hit the ball. This means that actually several gestures are combined at the same time, simultaneously in this motion. And surprisingly, this aspect of motion combination have been mostly unstudied in robotics and machine learning. So this somehow cryptic diagram gives us another example of motions, of gestures that are combined in parallel. So this description of a choreography using the a notation system developed by the choreographer Rudolf Laban. Actually, it's organized along two dimensions. The first one is time, and the other one is concurrency. So that each gesture here represents a simple, each symbol here represents a simple gesture, and symbols that are aligned horizontally represent gestures that are combined at the same time, and symbols that are aligned vertically represent gestures that are combined in sequence. So in the following, we present experiments in which primitive dance gestures are learned from records of a human dancer. However, the human only demonstrates complex choreographies, that mean that are the composition of several gestures at the same time. And to our knowledge, this problem has not been addressed before. So a famous problem among acousticians is the blind source separation problem. It's also known as the cocktail party effect. So this refers to the ability we have to focus on one speaker, although he is surrounded by a large amount of people also speaking. Another illustration of that problem is the fact that we can listen to and separate sounds from several instruments grouped in an orchestra. Importantly, this is an ambiguous problem. That means that it has several possible solutions. Actually, the motion decomposition problem I presented before is also ambiguous for similar reasons. Common computational approach to this problem use independent component analysis or dictionary learning. And following the analogy between the motion decomposition and sound decomposition, we will also use the non-negative matrix factorization technique in our work. Also, speech is a highly structured acoustic signal, but although we are very used to perceiving that structure, it is actually a difficult and ambiguous problem. For example, allophones are sounds that seem similar to us because they have the same function of our in our language, but for a foreigner, they would look completely different. Another example of ambiguity in speech is a segmentation problem. Indeed, there is no equivalent of spaces between written words in the acoustic domain of speech. Therefore, it is an ambiguous signal, and here you have examples that illustrate the ambiguity in the case of written language or spoken language. Common method to model language acquisition use dynamic time warping, but also, again, hidden Markov models and dictionary learning. In particular, the experiments developed by Driessen and colleagues are closely related to the one we are going to present after. So the experiments we developed and that I am going to present address several aspects of the problem of identifying primitive patterns in a flow of multimodal perception composed of speech, motion, and vision. In particular, we developed methods to learn from several modalities that contains raw continuous signal. Their objective is to find patterns in each of the modalities, but also to learn the combinatorial structure of these patterns. And finally, the association between patterns from several modalities. So here are some studies that look at similar problems, but either in one modality, or with an independent pre-training of one modality, or that use symbolic representations for one modality. Also, several approaches to multimodal learning actually consider the fusion of modalities to solve, for example, supervised classification tasks. Instead, we are going to study on multimodal learning on unsupervised multimodal learning, more precisely. So finally, several previous work have been targeting the problem of relating words to meaning, that is known as the symbol grounding problems. We also address that problem, but we address it as an instance of multimodal learning. And so in comparison to these other works, we do not rely on a phoneme recognizer to pre-process the speech data. And also, our approach treats speech and other modalities in a symmetric manner. So we don't introduce dissymmetry between speech and other modalities. So I will first present an experiment about discovering the structure of choreographies that combine several gestures at the same time. The signal for this experiment is composed of a continuous motion perception and a discrete linguistic channel. Then a second experiment demonstrates the learning of the association between two or three modalities, and these modalities contains raw continuous data. Finally, last experiment consider only one modality and explore the question of the decomposition of behaviors in a way that they can be imitated. So we now look at the first experiment. I will start by formulating the problem, then I will detail the algorithm, the give information about the data we use, and also present the result we obtained. So in this experiment, we focus on complex motions, as the one represented at the bottom here, that are obtained by producing simultaneously several gestures from a dictionary, such as the one presented here. For yes. The question we ask is then, is it possible for an artificial system that only perceives the complex composition of gestures to learn a dictionary of meaningful primitive gestures? And the gestures must be such that they represent well, they enable to approximate well the choreographies, and also to represent the notion of combination in these choreographies. The word meaningful here is actually unclear. Do we mean meaningful for the artificial system, and how can we evaluate that, or meaningful for human? And then it may mean that the system perceives the same gesture that we do. So actually, these are very subjective measures, so we are going to introduce two heuristics that are more objective that we are going to use in the experiments. The first one is that the observation, that is to say the choreographies, have to be well explained by the acquired dictionary of gestures. And the second one is that the combinatorial structure of choreographies must be well captured by the system. So now comes the question of the evaluation of such a learner. So to answer that question, we take another perspective. We assume that each demonstration is given together with a linguistic description of the choreography. During training, the system perceives both the demonstration of the choreographies and its description. And this compose a multimodal signal with two modalities that are the motion modality and the linguistic modality. In this first experiment, we further assume that the linguistic modality is composed of symbols. So here, the Laban annotations of the choreographies. And we assume that each symbol describes completely the choreography. So more precisely, we simply represent these symbols as a set of integers, and each primitive gesture that compose the choreography is associated with one symbolic label from the linguistic modality. So the goal of the learning system is then to produce a symbolic description when it is given a new demonstration of a choreography. Importantly, we test the system on describing correctly choreographies that are combinations of gestures that have not been observed during the training. Therefore, the task cannot be solved by recognizing the motion as a whole, but the system has to instead recognize each gesture inside the choreography to be able to recognize unknown motions. And thus, this task enables us to evaluate the ability of the system to perceive the structure of motions. The technique we use is a dictionary learning technique. That means that it learns a dictionary of primitive units, such that these units can be combined to explain a set of observations. Here, the set of pictures on the right can be combined to explain or to approximate the faces on the left. More precisely, we use non-negative matrix factorization. It's a specific instance of matrix factorization, which formalizes as follows. Is each example from the observation is represented as a vector, and these vectors are stacked into a data matrix. and then the algorithm tries to find a factorization of this matrix into two smaller matrices that are a dictionary and a coefficient matrix. In other words, each observation is approximated as a linear combination of the units from the dictionary with the coefficients. This can be seen as a compression operation because these matrices are smaller, so the data is represented by a smaller matrix, which is the coefficients. And so the objective of the algorithm is to perform this operation with minimal loss with respect to this measure of disparity. In order to use this technique for the composition of motion, we have to define a representation of the motion, such as the weighted sum of representations of motions correspond to the representation of the combination of the actual motions. So mathematically, we have now to define what the approximately equals means. So let V be the data matrix, W and H the dictionary and coefficient matrices. The non-negative matrix factorization focuses on the case where the data is composed actually of non-negative values. And it also further constrains the dictionary and coefficient matrices to also have non-negative values. Then it formalizes into this problem where the function D measures the reconstruction error between the original data matrix and its factorization. The function R is an eventual regularizer that can be added to enforce other properties on the matrices such as sparsity. And finally, the parameter k, which is the common dimension between W and H, it's also the number of atoms in the decomposition, and it's an important parameter of our setup and of the algorithm. The use of non-negative matrix factorization rather than, say, another matrix factorization technique enables the addition of components and not their subtractions. So therefore, these constraints can lead the components to be more easy to interpret. In practice, we explore two definitions of the measure of reconstruction error. One is the Frobenius Euclidean norm on matrices. The other one is the high divergence. Actually, this is a generalization of the Kullback-Leibler divergence. And the Kullback-Leibler divergence is an information theoretic measure of the disparity, the difference between two probability distributions. And therefore, this measure may be more relevant when we look at data that is composed, for example, of histograms. So among the various available algorithms, we focus on alternate methods. They consist of two alternative steps that optimize the problem with respect to the dictionary and with respect to the coefficients. More precisely, we use multiplicative updates that can be summarized into this formula with basic matrix operations. So let's go back to our multimodal learning setup. Our data actually consists of several modalities. Therefore, the observations from each modality are represented by a vector, and we stack all these vectors so that the multimodal observation is also represented by a vector. Therefore, the atoms of the dictionary have the same structure, and they actually encode patterns in each modality, but also the association between patterns from several modalities. The coefficients are called from no internal representation since there are a compressed version of the original signal with respect to the dictionary. So once the dictionary has been learned during the evaluation, the system only perceives an example in one modality here, and the algorithm actually enables us to find a coefficient vector H here that is that best approximates the observed example with respect to the dictionary, the part of the dictionary in this modality. And then what we can do from this coefficient that is an internal representation of the observed signal, we can compute the expected perception in another modality by just multiplying this coefficient vector with the dictionary part for the other modality. So in our setting, we use this process to transform an observation of a choreography to an internal representation. And then the internal representation, so this uses the motion part of the dictionary, and then the internal representation is transformed into a linguistic reconstruction of the signal using the linguistic part of the dictionary. So for the specific case of our experiment, the linguistic modality contains labels and it's that are actually represented by a binary vector. And this vector has the one in position I if and only if the label I is present in the choreography. So next, the algorithm perceives an example and returns a vector of non-negative continuous values through the process I've just explained. And therefore, in order to compare the linguistic, the description, the reconstruction of the description by the system with the ground truth description of the choreographies, we have to go through thresholding mechanisms where the threshold is learned by cross-validation and which yield a binary vector, which is the description of the observed choreography by the system. And next, we evaluate this binary vector using the following score function that gives score 1 if and only if the two vectors are completely equal. So for example, here the system gets a 0 score because it added one additional label, although it had found the two good labels. So it's really evaluating the complete complete description of the gesture. So we recorded a data set of choreographies by asking a human demonstrator in front of a Kinect device to perform two or three gestures at the same time. So the tracking device and the associated software give us access to the sequence of body position. And so here you have some examples of choreographies as they are tracked by the device and presented to the system, to the learning system. So you can see also that the choreographies are of variable length and also that they include both rhythmic motions and discrete motions. We actually consider two data sets. One is composed of 16 primitive motions that are combined together into 137 examples, and the other one has 47 primitive motions combined into 277 examples. So interestingly, the second data set contains far less examples than the total number of gesture combinations, which is here more than 2,000. Actually, each combination of primitive gesture is only demonstrated a small number of times, and many are only recorded once. So this is illustrated in these histograms that present the distribution of record in the dataset relatively to the number of occurrence in the dataset of the combination of gestures that they contain. So importantly, the second dataset more than 60% of the records demonstrates a choreography that is never observed again in the dataset. In order to use that approach to use the non-negative matrix factorization approach with this data, we have to define a non-negative motion representation such as the combination of gestures translates to the linear combination of their representation. So for that, we use the following representation. The Kinect device yields a sequence of positions of each joint. So we treat independently each of the body joints, for example, here the shoulder. We compute a derivative of the angle values, which we call velocity. And then we count the occurrences of the pairs of angle and velocity. We count them in a discretized way. And this yields a two-dimensional histogram that that is a kind of signature of the motion on that joint. We do that for each body joint. And then we concatenate all these histograms into a big non-negative vector that represent the motion. And this vector is typically of dimension 450. So here are the results for that experiment. So the table presents an average score of correct reconstruction of the linguistic description over a set of choreographies. The results are presented in four rows for the two data sets and the two versions of the algorithm for the two measures of disparity, which are Frobenius and Kullback-Leibler divergence. The left column presents result obtained on without restriction on the set of choreographies used for testing the system, and this column is obtained with choreography used to test the system that were never observed during the training. So this is combination of gestures that the system has never observed before, and these results compared with the high number of possible combination of gestures shows that the system is capable of leveraging the structure of the motions to recognize new choreographies. So some limitations of this experiment are that we only evaluated the algorithm on concurrent combination of motion primitives, not on sequences or a mix of both. Also, when we build this histogram, we lose a lot of information so that we cannot imitate the motion from the representation of our system. And we are addressing some aspect related to that limitation in the third experiment. And finally, we introduce symbolic description. So we don't consider in that experiment raw signal for modalities. And we are going to remove this limitation in the next experiment. So here we only consider raw signals, and we are trying to learn the associations between gestures, words, and objects. In particular, we do not use a phoneme recognizer, for example, to pre-process the speech modality. I will first present how we modified the evaluation setup, then present the data we used, and then give quantitative results before explaining how the experiment models the emergence of grounded words. So we consider the same setup as before, except that now the input is composed of two or three raw continuous modalities. Here you have simple gestures. We have removed the hypothesis of combinatorial structure of the gestures and spoken utterances. The system doesn't observe the transcription, and sentence, you've got one word here, circle, and here, clapping, that describes the gesture. And the sentence are actually composed of several words, but only one is relevant for describing the gestures. So this configuration implements a cross-modal cross-situational learning setup, because the word circle is always encountered in the context of the gesture circles, and conversely. In this setup, we evaluate the system on the reconstruction of we cannot evaluate it anymore on the reconstruction of a symbolic modality, so we use a new kind of classification setup, where the system is given a spoken utterance and has to choose among a set of gestures the one that is best described by the spoken utterance. Alternately, we can give it a gesture and find among a set of sentences the one that best describes the gesture. So we use the same algorithm as before, but in a different way. First, the multimodal dictionary is trained from the multimodal examples. And then the system is given, for example, a test sentence. It computes then its internal representation. It is also given a set of reference motions, computes their internal representations, and then the system compares between the internal representation of the speech and the internal representations of each of the gestures and chooses the closest. It gets a score of 1 if it chooses the good gesture, the one that is well described by the description. So in practice, we use one candidate gesture of each type, so in the experiment, 10 candidate gestures. So we can consider similar setups. Here it means that one motion has to be associated from one sound has to be associated from one motion among a set of 10 motions, but we can have the symmetric setups also. So in order to compare the internal representations, we used a measure called cosine similarity. This is a measure between two vectors that is basically the normalized version of the scalar product of the two vectors. So we used data from the following modalities. First, we use a set of records of 10 basic gestures. They are represented as we explained before. Then we use sounds from the Acorns caregiver dataset. It consists of sentences, each containing one keyword from a set of 10. And we use, similarly to the work from Driesen and colleagues, we use a representation of speech that is based on a histogram of co-occurrences of local descriptors of the speech. And typically the dimensionality of this representation is around 10,000. 100,000, sorry. And finally, this representation also has an additive property, which is that if we put if we look at the concatenation of two sentences, it is going to be represented approximately by the linear combination of the representation of each of the sentences. So now some examples.
Take a bath. To push in the bath is not funny either.
Okay, so finally we use a set of pictures that was extracted from the vision of an iCube robot and a Kinect device by Natalia Lyubova and David Filia. Each image contains one of the 10 objects presented here, and eventually also the hand of the operator. Interestingly, the objects look very different depending on the point of view. And the representation of picture we use is also based on a histogram of occurrence of local descriptors of the images. And this representation also transforms the juxtaposition of two objects in an image into a linear mixture of their representation. The objects here are represented by a vector of dimensionality around 50,000. So for the experiment, we build an artificial set of semantic associations between objects, gestures, and descriptions, and keywords from the spoken descriptions. The cross-situational setup is thus modeled by the fact that each example from the experiment presents stimuli in each modality that belongs to the same cross-model class. And we use a set of 1,000 examples, such as this one. So now some quantitative results. So this result presents the scores of the cross-modal association task. The score is the proportion of time the algorithm had associated, for example, the right motion to a given speech description. The score that a system choosing the association by random would get is around 10%. So in the figure, there are four groups of results. The three first one present results for a system that is learned on only two modalities. And the third group, the fourth group present results for a system that is learned on, that is trained on the three modalities. And in each group, you have results for different setup of the task, such as given an image, find the good motion among a set of motion that correspond to this image. So this result show a good score for the various tasks, which demonstrate that the learning of the cross-modal associations is effective. Interestingly, there is not a lot of differences between the same task in a setup where the system is trained on two modalities or in a setup where the system is trained on three modalities. So the experiment I presented is actually solving an instance of the thimble grounding problem. The thimble grounding problem is the problem to learning both symbols such as words and their meaning. In the experiment, the artificial learner discovers the associations between spoken sentences and gestures or objects in images. Interestingly, this process happens from raw signal, and thus the result can be interpreted as the grounding of the meaning of full sentences in the vision modality. I am now going to quickly present a modification of that setup. to test if there is actually a grounding of the meanings of words behind the grounding of full sentences. So in order to investigate which part of the sentences are associated with the object, we build an artificial video. So this video, the audio part of this video is composed of a sequence of sentences that are concatenated, and the visual part is composed of a sequence of images at a given frame rate, and each image, in each frame that appear at the same time of the sentence, the object is of the same cross-modal class than the class of the sentence. So then the video is split into short time windows, and the learner is trained on considering each window as an independent example. So to evaluate the system, we are going to extract several similar windows, but only from the speech modality. And then each of these windows will represent a part of a sentence, and we will look at the association between part of sentences and objects from the visual modality. So the figure presents some results that we can get. So the time goes from left to right, and if we are going along a curve, we look at the association between the object of the class bath with several parts of the sentence along time. So in this example, the blue curve shows that the first half of the sentence, "to put it in the bath isn't funny either," is perceived as closer to the symbol bass than the other part of the sentence. Similarly, the purple curves show that the meaning, the starting of the sentence "mummy is lazy and doesn't do anything" is more associated to the class, the visual class of object mummy. The beginning of the sentence is more associated to the visual class. So these qualitative results suggest that the meaning of word is actually localized in the sentence at the same position than the actual word. That is to say, the grounding of sentences led to the grounding of words. So I will now explain some work we've done to use similar ideas in order to decompose the motion in a way that enables the reproduction of the behavior by a learner. I'll first explain the main idea and then present results. So we present a setup in which an artificial system is learning by demonstration. More precisely, a teacher demonstrates several different tasks to the learner, and the tasks all have a common structure. And we are not aware of other works that target the learning of a common structure of several tasks. So we bring together two ideas. The first one is the one from inverse reinforcement learning. Basically, inverse reinforcement learning is the problem of learning the objective of an agent by looking at its actions. More precisely, the objective is modeled as a reward that the agent gets for doing the right action in the right state. For example, an agent moves on a grid and gets a reward that is here more important on dark blue cells than on white cells. So if an agent knows the tasks, it can reproduce a trajectory that is optimal with respect to that task. Then an apprentice that observes this agent can use these trajectories to try to learn its own model of the task that is solved. So here it means that the apprentice tries to reconstruct the repartition of reward on the grid from the observation of trajectories. So our motivation is that having a good model of the task can lead to better generalization to new situations. For example, this agent here, if it's just from a new situation, if it just copies the trajectories of the demonstrator, this is not efficient, and if it learns the task, it can plan a new trajectory that is more efficient. We now bring together the idea with the one of perceiving primitive tasks that compose behavior. For that, we consider a setting in which the tutor agent solves a task that is composed of several subtasks. So for example, the behavior of driving a car would be composed to several tasks that reward avoiding obstacles, riding on the right of the road, respecting traffic lights, avoiding tolls, and going, of course, to a destination. However, in another situation, the preferences of the agent may change, and then it may be solving another task for a new destination, which involves riding on the left of the road and being in a hurry, so don't bother paying tolls, for example. We thus developed an algorithm to solve that problem for the observation of a tutor that demonstrates several tasks that are different but related, and the algorithm tries to learn a dictionary of primitive tasks from these observations. So in other words, we look at the decomposition of a behavior, not in the space of trajectories, but in the space of tasks. So most work in inverse reinforcement learning have focused on either a single task, eventually learning a set of relevant features for that task, or several alternative tasks, but non-mixed, often with clustering approaches. But we are not aware of works that can leverage the common structure of several complex mixed tasks. In the experiment we consider, a tutor uses a set of dictionary of primitive tasks to generate random commutation of these primitive tasks into complex tasks and give demonstrations only for these tasks. The apprentice uses the demonstration to build its own model, its own set of primitive tasks that he thinks are relevant to explain the behavior of the demonstrator. And finally, it observes one demonstration of a new complex task and has to build its own model of the task, and it is evaluated on its ability to solve that task in new situations. This can be seen as learning to drive in France and going to Great Britain and try to imitate the local way of driving. So this graph presents how far the apprentice is from the optimal behavior for the task. So the best one can achieve is zero. And the lower is better. The black curve here represents the performance of an apprentice who knows the true dictionary of primitive tasks and just tries to imitate a new task composed of elements from this dictionary. In blue, we have our learner that tries to learn its own dictionary of subtasks and uses it to infer and imitate a new task that is given to it. And on the opposite, the red curve represents a learner that doesn't try to infer the dictionary and just learn from scratch each new task. So here we get much better results with the factorial learner that try to learn the structure of the task than the flat learner that doesn't try to learn the structure. And other naive approaches to solve the same problems actually do even worse than the flat learner. So now some element of conclusion. We first studied an original aspect of motion combination that we framed into a multimodal setup where linguistic labels help to remove the ambiguity of the decomposition problem of motions. We then replaced the linguistic channel with real speech. And although it seems that this problem is made more difficult because the learner now has to discover patterns in two high-dimensional noisy channels, we show that each modality helps selecting relevant patterns in the other modalities. We achieve these results through an original use of feature learning, or feature learning techniques, and we developed an appropriate setup for evaluation of the unsupervised multimodal learning problem. We explained how the experiment achieves the form of grounding grounding of acoustic words without segmentation of the speech or use of a static phoneme recognizer. And interestingly, this result is an example where holistic understanding of the sentences actually precedes and acts as a proxy to the understanding of parts of the sentences that are words. And also, we demonstrate We finally we presented an approach to extend the learning of the structure of motion to an imitation setup, and for that we considered a setup in which an apprentice must learn to solve an unknown task by observing a tutor demonstrating related but distinct tasks. We showed that our approach enables the learners to leverage once again the common structure of tasks in order to imitate the new task. So the motion dataset as well as code for the multimodal experiment have been made publicly available. So no some limitations. First, we can think of several technical improvements that can be brought to the algorithms I presented. Some of them would eventually enable new experimental setups. For example, we use the compression heuristics in the algorithm, but it could be changed, for example, to enforce sparsity of the representation, or also to favor the cross-modal dependency between patterns or other similar ideas. Another example of improvement would be to change the inverse reinforcement learning algorithm in order to extend our approach to more realistic problems. And in particular, it would enable the validation of the hypothesis we make that your human tasks are actually composed of several subtasks. We studied the parallel combination of motions. However, we have not yet tested our approach on learning gestures from both parallel and sequential combinations. So the grammatical structure of motion is a very interesting perspective. Indeed, we draw a parallel between the structure of language and the structure of motion, and such effort could be extended to the parallel between the grammar of motion and the grammar of language. We grounded our two first experiments in a cross-situational learning setup, and we tested it on data where modality were artificially associated. One interesting use of that model would be to measure the efficiency of the cross-situational strategy on learning from data that is acquired from real interaction between a human and a baby or a human and a robot. Also, other algorithms could be developed to explore and compare other heuristics for the learning of words and their meanings. Finally, we focus our study mainly on the structure of perception. An interesting extension could be to develop studies that enable to look with more details into how the structuration of perceptions can structure the action, and conversely, how the structure of action also structures the data that is perceived, and therefore the perception itself. Thank you for your attention.